Welcome. I'm Pastor Greg of Calvary Reformed Church, Mattawan, Michigan. Welcome to our teaching ministry. We're in the midst of looking at a purpose-driven life. What's the purpose in our lives? Why have we been created? A few weeks ago, we looked at the fact that there is a plan because God created each one of us. We're just not a happenstance. We just we're not here just because we climbed out of the mud and the slime. But God created you, God created me. He created us with purpose. He created us with a reason for our existence. And the last couple of weeks we've talked about sort of looking within our lives, but looking in Scripture. And today we're going to spend today and the next 4 weeks after this looking at some specific purposes within our lives. But before we do that, let's have a word of prayer. Father God, as we come before you, Lord, I'd ask for wisdom so that I could lead people to you. And Lord, I'd ask that people that watch this, Lord, that they will be educated and engaged and learn something new within their life. We ask this in your name. Amen. Well, if you think about it, what's your goal of life? What is your goal? What's your purpose of life? Is your purpose to find that right spouse? Is your purpose to raise children? Is your purpose to get that certain education, be it through college or be it through VOTEC, be it through job training? Is your purpose in life to have a large retirement plan? Is your purpose in life to travel? Is your purpose in life to get to that point where you don't have to do anything anymore? Is your purpose in life to have pleasure? Lots of pleasure. Well, I don't know about you, friends, but I know for me that all that I just listed, all those things listed don't satisfy my soul, don't satisfy who I am, how God has created me. And God knows the purpose and the plan within my life. Well, within the series, what we're looking at is a purpose-driven life. And yes, we are springboarding off of Rick Warren's book, Purpose-Driven Life, that he wrote 20 years ago. But we're looking in Scripture, because Scripture has to be the authority for our life. Has to be the authority. Well, I find it interesting that within Scripture, it talks about the fact that Isaiah 63, verse 3 says, God planted them like strong and graceful oaks for his own glory. Do you realize, folks, our number one purpose is to give God glory? The number one aspect of our life, from the womb to the tomb, is for us to be in worship, for us to be in praise of what God has done for us, for us to lift up our voices, to lift up our hands, to lift up our spirits, our souls, in worship and praise. That's the number one. Well, I'm sitting here within the sanctuary here at Calvary Reformed Church. Some of you know what it looks like. Some have never been here before. We invite you to attend. And this is where we gather to worship once a week. But as we go through this teaching, we need to realize that worship, yes, does happen in a sanctuary, but worship is also called to happen throughout the entire week. Not just Sunday morning or Saturday night for a certain amount of time, but the entire week. Now, here comes the trick. I've been told by some people right now coming through COVID, you know, Pastor, we are worshiping, but we are staying away from the church and we're worshiping by ourselves at home. Yes, we can do that. And yet then we're forgetting what the Scriptures calls us to do when the Scripture says in Hebrews, don't neglect to meet together. Meet together as the body of believers. The body of believers. That's how we grow, how we learn, how we support, how we uplift one another as we meet together in worship and gather together to be in worship. So where I'm going with that, friends, is we're going to look at some different points of what worship is, but I want to just lay it out there at first. Worship happens in a sanctuary, but this is not the only place that worship happens. Worship also happens in your daily walk of life. 24/7, we are called to be in worship. Not neglecting to meet together, as some are getting in the habit of, and they were in the habit 2,000 years ago, as the author of Hebrews says, but gathering weekly to be in worship with one another for God, but also a weekly worship, daily worship in your life. Okay, with that laid out as sort of the forefront idea, worship has a couple ideas. Worship, it focuses our attention on God. How much of our life don't we focus on ourselves? What Greg wants, what Greg needs, oh, my emotions, my feelings, my yada, yada, yada. We focus on ourselves. But worship calls us to focus. I talked about this a few weeks ago on one of the videos of with this teaching, that the focus, worship focus, is it's like using a scope on a gun. And you're able to focus and put those crosshairs on what you're hunting for, that deer or that elk or that moose or that bear. And you focus on that. You hone it in. Focus. Worship helps us focus our lives. Isaiah 26 says, "You will keep in perfect peace all who trust in you, whose thoughts are fixed on you." What our eyes look at is where we go. What our eyes look at is where our heart goes. Where our eyes look is where our emotions go. Where our eyes, you follow what I'm saying? What we focus on is that which we become. I can recall my dad as a pastor. He used the illustration many, many times. He grew up in Pella, Iowa, and he grew up as a teenager, and when they would have to plow the field, and if they would use the horse, or would use at that point in time a very small tractor, if he would focus on what was going on behind, his road would get very crooked. He would have to focus on that point that was ahead. And as you focus on that point ahead, you can then plant your rows straight. Worship calls us to focus on God, fix our eyes on God. It also calls us to surrender. Ooh, that's not a very nice word today in our English language, is it? Surrender. No, we pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We are a self-made man or a woman. I can do it by myself. I don't need anybody else, especially a supreme being. No, worship helps us focus on God, and worship calls us to surrender our lives. Paul says in Romans 6:13, give yourselves completely to God. Surrendering, friends, is our heart of worship. Lord, it's not me, but it's you. Lord, it's not anything I can do, but it's what you do through me. Lord, I give you praise and worship. I surrender my life to you. But worship is also, as we focus on God, it's seeking God. Seeking God 24/7. Not simply on Sunday morning when you come to worship for an hour, hour and a half. But it's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It's seeking God, is opening up your Bible, opening up the wonderful apps that we have nowadays for our phones. I use YouVersion app all the time. It's opening that up and reading it, then just not reading the verse of the day, but read the whole chapter that the verse is part of it, and seeing what's going on. And friends, worship is seeking God. It's not checking off one of those obligations that we have. But worship focuses my attention on God. As I focus on God, as I surrender my life, as I seek Him 24/7. Worship also is to express my love to God. To express my affection to God. Now, I don't know about you, but I know for me, when I walk into a room, or if I go someplace to some loved ones that I haven't seen for a while, and when they smile, man, it just melts my heart. You know what I'm talking about. You haven't seen somebody, you haven't seen one of your kids or a family member or a loved one or a friend for a few years, and you see them, and man, you just beam and they beam because you are together and you put a smile on their face. Friends, that's what worship does to God. When we offer our affection, our love, our praise to God, it puts a smile on God's face. God smiles when we love Him supremely, when we give wholeheartedly to Him, when we trust Him completely, when we thank Him continually. He smiles. I love that idea that God smiles when I worship. Worship, I'm called to have my entire focus, my surrender, seeking God. Worship, I'm called to do aspects because it puts a smile on God's face. And isn't that beautiful to think about that? But it also, worship, I'm called to use my abilities, my God-given gifts, my God-given spiritual gifts, my natural abilities in worship. 2 Corinthians 5, 9 says, so we make it our goal to please God, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. Paul also says in Romans, I beseech you therefore, brothers, sisters, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Living sacrifice. We go back to surrendering. We got to surrender. Living sacrifice, meaning use your abilities. Friends, there is no church, no church. Calvary too, no church should have to ask for Sunday school, Camp Calvary, Bible school, cookie makers, leaders, singers. Need I go on? I don't care if your church has 25 people or if your church has 25,000 people. Every church is full of people who are able to step up with their abilities and bring worship to God to the utmost, to the best. We are called to give our best to God, not to give our whatever is left over, not to give our, you know, we really don't think we can do that. We are called to give our best. We are called to step up and use our abilities to surrender so that every house of worship, friends, I don't care if it's here at Calvary, I don't care if it's in California, I don't care if it's in Africa or if it's in China or the Middle East, every house of worship, every body of believers are called to use their abilities to worship God. Yes, in the corporate setting, also yes, in the individual setting, as they worship God. There's one more aspect here about worship I want to bring up, and that's that, what do we do when God seems distant? Being a pastor of pushing 34 or 35 years, I've dealt with a lot of family members who, and family, I mean church members and community members, who've lost family. Some of them, man, that first Sunday after they've lost family members, they are back in worship and praise. Others afterwards, they say, well, no, we're just not ready. Nope, we can't come back to worship. Nope, we can't. And I'm not judging anybody. I'm not. Don't hear me on that. But friends, in the midst of our pain of life, I think sometimes when the truest worship comes out, in the midst of our struggles of life, we gather with other believers and say, God, we don't understand this. God, where are you leading us? God, what's taking place within our lives? God, why did you allow this situation to take place within our family? And within that situation, we offer our deepest praise to God. And God says to us, Deuteronomy 31, he says, but he says in the New Testament a few times too, he's saying to Joshua, be strong, take courage, don't be intimidated. Don't give anybody else a second thought who's going to attack you. Don't give the circumstances around us a second thought of what's taking place. For God is striding ahead of you. God is running ahead of you. God is right there with you. God is before me. God is right next to me. He won't let you down. He won't leave you. Whatever you're going through in life, friends, I don't know what you're going through. Whether you're riding the crest of life, whether you're in the midst of despair, or somewhere in between. Our purpose, my purpose, my God-created purpose, biblically, is to first be in worship. Worship with the body of believers. As I focus, I surrender, I seek, use my abilities and offer my affection to God with the corporate, but also throughout the week, to focus my life on God and to worship Him daily. Name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit. Friends, my prayer is that you will look at some of these passages that we have up on the screen, and that you will look in your own life and say, okay, Lord, where are you calling me to grow in my depth of my worship experience with you? And it's not just a feeling experience, but it's the worship act that we take within our lives, worshiping, focusing, surrendering, seeking, bringing a smile to God's face, using our abilities to offer him worship and praise. Amen. Thank you for watching.